Dear God, I love you so much, and I appreciate you so much, and I know that you know that always, forever, and for infinity, and I will continue on the path to grow, to be better, to be more righteous, to be more holy, to be more pure, to be in a better position to teach your children, to clean my heart from any dislike, to always trust you like Nahum ben Gamzu, to be on that level. I want to be on a level where I could trust you, Hashem. I'm not asking you to test me. And we learned that from King David. Don't ever say, yeah, yeah, test me, because the test could break you. You know what I mean? Don't do that. I'm going to tell you some beautiful secrets, man, about the book of Samuel. I'm going to get right into it. Even though I'm going to tell you about the second book of Samuel right now, I start off my notes with Exodus. Watch this. Exodus 33:12. Moses said, I made prominent your name. I like that. That's what it is. It's about bringing sanctification to God's name. They say that King David sanctified the name of God more than any other king. That's what made him so special. Every time he went to war, he consulted with the Sanhedrin and with the Kohen Gadol, with the Kohen priest, to know, should I go to war or not? Is it going to be good? Is God with me? Do we have favor? It's amazing. King David, boy, he is on another level, man. I'm going to tell you some secrets quick about King David, and then we're going to get into some of my notes that will further solidify his greatness and his righteousness. We know that he's super righteous. Why? Because he wrote the book of Tehillim? That's a good reason. But what made him have that righteousness to write the book of Tehillim? You know what it was? Admitting when he did something wrong. Not making excuses, not looking to justify it, not looking of ways to squirm out of it, not passing the buck, not trying to justify it in a way that's slick. Because none of these things will work with God, so you're just wasting your time. King David was smart enough to understand that. I might as well just admit the truth, say I'm sorry, and wish and hope for God's mercy. And that's exactly what he did, and he got it. When Hashem punished King David, when he lost a son, Bathsheba had a son, when he was with her, when he wasn't supposed to be with her, and the way it played out was amazing, man. The Satan had permission to test him. Why? Because he said to God, test me like you tested Avram, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. If they're so great because they got tests and they passed the test and that's what made them great, I also want to test. And then right away, he went on the roof. He looked and he saw a dove. He took his bow and arrow. He went to shoot it. He missed. He hit a sheet. The sheet tore. And he got a look at Bathsheba bathing on her roof. And his desires were kindled. And then he concocted a plan to be with her. And although some of the things he did in the plan were kosher, it's very clear that he did something wrong. A, God said, you did what was evil in my eyes. It's very simple. If God is saying that, it doesn't matter what men are saying. You understand? And we know that God punished him by killing his son, the son that he had with Bathsheba. But after he took that son away, within 30 days, his 7 days he got sick, and within 7 days he died. So within 30 days, there's different opinions, but we know that from the book of Shmuel, he didn't really mourn. So we know that's why it was within 30 days. King David, man, tough warrior, but at the same time, loving, compassionate, and merciful. And it's crazy because if you look at some of the things in the Torah and the scriptures in the book of prophets that speak about King David, why? Don't give him bad news, bro. They used to give him some bad news. This dude will like kill you. Crazy. Yeah, look, I'll give you proof. When they killed Ishbosheth, they came back, they told him he had them killed. There was another one who told him something. Oh yeah, Doeg the Edomite. When he told him about Shaul died, he killed him. It's crazy how Hashem brought these guys through him, thinking they did something good because they were trying to curry favor with him. They saw that it was impure. He saw that it wasn't real. And saw that they did it just to do it, to save their own self. He wasn't with that. King David, why? King David gave birth to Solomon. And who gave birth to Solomon? Bathsheba. And that was right after Hashem killed her son. She had a son. He died. He got sick and he died. And then shortly after, she got pregnant and she gave birth to King Solomon. And you know what's so special about King Solomon? I tell you what, that he had the schut to build the first temple. But what's even more amazing about King Solomon is that when King David was given the kingship of Israel and Judah, and I said Israel and Judah, absolutely, because in the end he was the king over all. It took years with Ishbosheth and with King Shaul, and he humbled himself the whole time. The whole time he didn't complain, man. He just accepted what God did. And he realized that in the end, it's all gonna work out, yo. And I need to do the same thing in my life, because I've seen some things that are really not nice. And it's a beautiful lesson for me to learn, just like King David. Keep doing the right thing. Keep working on your ego. Keep always tell yourself, put your ego low. Let it go and let God run the show. That King David would put his stamp on, Hashem would put his stamp on that. That's how powerful that statement is, you understand? And that will bring you mental peace and happiness. Absolutely, that will give you the best mental health ever. You'll never get upset. I was just talking to my moms. And what were we saying? When a person is humble, he has no problems. He has no issues with nobody. He's not getting into fights. He's not arguing with the office. He's not doing this. He's not... Nothing. He lets it go. He puts his ego low and lets God run the show. And I think every Jew and non-Jew should do that. The world would be a much better place to live in. I can guarantee you that. Nobody would sue each other. Nobody would get mad at each other. A guy would catch his girl cheating on him. He wouldn't beat her up. The opposite. He'd smile, say, "You're not the one for me. You're lost," and keep it moving. That's the kind of power that trust in God gives you. It gives you such a mental health. It's like a force field of a billion angels around your brain, destroying any negativity that comes with even close. They can't even infiltrate. You understand? It will never be allowed to come in, because it's a bunch of fiery angels, just like the fire around Jerusalem protect Jerusalem. Same thing here. It will protect your soul. It will protect your mental peace. It will give you such happiness. You'll get heaven in this world. Because what's heaven? Heaven is the ultimate peace. There are sometimes in this world where you have that. It's fleeting. Comes and goes, bro. Comes and goes. You know what I mean? This is the way it is. Because that's this world. You know what I'm saying? It's ups and downs. It's like a ladder. Just like with the dream that Jacob had. Up and down. That's how it is. Sometimes you're going to go up. Sometimes you're going to go down. But you know what? I got a secret for you. There is a way to constantly go up. To stick to God and follow his Torah. Watch. Exodus 33:12. Moses said, "I made prominent your name." That's a Kiddush Hashem. That's what King David. King David was known as the king that sanctified God's name the most. Remember that. God is made great in the eyes of the people for no other reason than there's none like him. That being so, we're obligated to serve him, even if he were to grant us no reward. That's deep. Daniel 11:16. The land of Israel is called the land of splendor. Malachi 2:10. Have we not all one Father? Has not one God created us? We have one Torah, one law. So it's only fitting that we have one heart and one will. Lamentations 5:21. Return to us, O God, and we will return to you. When King David fled into the forest of Charet, the king of Moab had David's parents and brothers put to death. 1 Samuel 22:5. Scripture relates that Balaam was filled with the spirit of prophecy. He said, "I see it, but not now. I perceive it, but not in the near future. A star shall go forth from Jacob, and a staff shall rise from Israel, crushing all of Moab's princes and devastating all of Seth's descendants." Numbers 24:17. He was referring to the two who would emerge from Israel to punish the children of Moab, David and the Messiah. This is why Balak, king of Moab, was so afraid of Israel, and why Balaam advised him to bait the Jewish warriors with Moabite women. Unbelievable. That's the story of Zimri ben Salu and Cozbi. That was a Midianite princess that Hashem's a Midianite or a Moabite. let's see, probably a Moabite, but could also be a Midianite. We'll have to figure it out. Princess to go make Kospi sleep with Zimri ben Salu. She was looking for Moshe Rabbeinu to be with. Sick. Jacob made a treaty with Lavan the Aramean. He said, Lavan said, I know that God will one day give all of these lands to you and your descendants. Let us make a treaty and give me your word that your sons will not take away the land belonging to Aram. Genesis 31, Lavan and Jacob swore that neither one would cross the mound where their peace monument was set up. A king is not spared by a great army. False is the horse for salvation. Despite its great strength, it provides no escape. Behold, the eye of God is on those who fear him. Psalms 33:16-18. Now I'm going to tell you something deep in Proverbs. Proverbs 15:7. When a man's ways please God, even his enemies are at peace with him. We learn this from Toi, the king of Hamath, who brought tribute to David, sending him precious vessels of every sort. Second book of Samuel 8:12. King David took silver and gold from Aram, from Moab, from the Plishtim, from Amalek, and from the spoils of Adedzer, the son of Rahov, king of Zobah. Look at all of the battles that Hashem helped King David win. Why? Because he trusted in him like Nahum ben Gamzu. That's why. David rose to fame and prominence after defeating the Edomites because he ordered Joab to bury the dead of the enemy forces. First book of Kings 11:15. That's what's called the compassionate warrior. David rose to fame and prominence after defeating the Edomites because he ordered Joab to bury the dead of the enemy forces. First book of Kings 11:15. I love giving the sources. No king succeeded in sanctifying the name of God the way David did. If I'm not mistaken, I said that 3 times on this talk to hammer home the point to let you know. Numbers 23:7. Bilam came from Aram to curse Jacob and conjure up divine wrath against Israel. The peace treaty Jacob made with Lavan from Aram was broken when Bilam came to curse Israel. Deuteronomy 18:13. You must remain totally faithful to God your Lord. Amen. Psalms 121:2. King David said, my help is from God. Genesis 25:23. Nations are in your womb. The upper hand will go from one to the other. When the Jews behave, their enemies are subdued. When they don't, they rise up. I'm just going to take a pause right now to speak quickly about anti-Semitism. I just explained to you the secret of it right there. When we do the right thing, there cannot be any anti-Semitism. Even if there was a goy that wanted to do the most damage to Eretz Israel, Hashem would bury him in his thought. You understand? But when we go against God, like we do today, and we ignore him, Shabbat, go talk to a Jew about Shabbat. Not all, obviously. 20% of our nation remains purer than pure. Amen. And Hashem should bless them and rise them up to the highest heights, which he'll do anyway. He doesn't need me to explain it, but it's for you to understand. You want anti-Semitism to stop? Stop doing the wrong thing. Like I told my mother, the chosen nation, we are. But we're only the chosen nation when we choose to do the right thing. That's why he chose us amongst all the nations. Gotta understand, man. Deuteronomy 28:48, you will serve your enemies. You think Hashem is not playing around? I'm sorry, you think Hashem is playing around? He's not playing around. Look how direct he talks. In your face, he tells you, you will serve your enemies. Why? Why would Hashem say that to his children that he loves so much, that you're going to serve your enemies? Because you didn't serve him. When you serve him the right way, he'll do for you a lot. David is described as a leader who executed justice and righteousness to his entire people. At midnight, he would rise to sing praises to God. And during the day, he would lead the people in the ways of the Lord. Amen. Yo, that's dope. Mighty is the king who loves justice. I got to put that on the t-shirt. Genesis 18:19. The Torah says this about Avram. And he will command his children and his household after him. And they will keep God's ways, doing righteousness and justice. It's a common theme in the Torah. You want peace, you want happiness, do righteousness and justice. It's very simple. He has beautiful eyes, and so he looked with compassion upon the world. First book of Samuel 16:12. David was worthy of the throne because he never defamed others. This was because he had a good heart, and good-hearted people do not speak disparagingly or allow words that may disgrace others to pass from their lips. Amen. But you know what King David did say? And there's an exception to the rule. Your enemies are my enemies. You understand? And I'm sure he put down some of the wicked and let them know to their face that if you don't respect God, that he will obliterate you. And then you're going to tell me, oh, no, I'm not going to fear God. Okay, so then when King Solomon said, Reshit Chochma Yirat Hashem, the foundation of wisdom is to fear God, what are you going to answer? The whole point of fearing God is so you don't sin. We say it in Berchat HaMazon. No, come on. King Shaul killed Achimelech, the high priest, in the city of Nov. Not only him, the 85 priests and everybody in the city, the cattle, the sheep, the goat, everything. And who did it? Doeg did it. But at whose order? King Shaul. Jonathan's son, who was crippled, was always welcome at King David's table. Why? King David honored him because of his love for Jonathan. Deuteronomy 23:7. You must never seek their peace or good. That's talking about Ammon and Moab. An ungrateful person is despised both by God and by man. Indeed, this is why it's forbidden to muzzle an ox when plowing with it. It's so important that we acknowledge the one from whom good is received. Beautiful. When King David was fleeing from Shaul, he took his family to take refuge with the king of Moab. After David fled to the forest of Charet, the king of Moab betrayed him and killed his entire family. The only one who survived was his brother, who escaped, Elihu. King David owed a debt of gratitude to Nahash, the Ammonite king, because he refused to hand over Elihu, David's brother, to Moab. I like that. This is speaking about Ammon and Moab, Deuteronomy 23:7. You must never seek their peace or good all your days forever. The word forever is spelled with an extra vav to indicate that even if they were to convert, they would still harbor hate in their heart. Evil, and they tried to embarrass. Here, I'm going to show you right now. King David made a big mistake. When the Ammonite king Nahash died, David sent comforters to his son Hanun. The Ammon princes convinced Hanun that David was actually trying to spy on the land. So he embarrassed the comforters by shaving their beard and cutting their clothes. These were holy, regal men that King David sent as a gesture of peace and love out of gratitude for what his father did for him. And look at what he did. He shamed the regal comforters. You'll see what happened to them coming up. It's not pretty. Aram came to the aid of Ammon and would pay a heavy price for that. Joshua 1:7. Just be very strong and steadfast to be careful to fulfill all of the Torah. Amen. Psalms 27:14. Wait with hope for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. And wait with hope for the Lord. Says it twice to let you know, never give up on hope. Like this, Hashem can change everything. Salvation from God has two prerequisites, human effort and trust in Him. Let me say that again. Salvation from God has two prerequisites, human effort and trust in God. Psalms 37:14 and 15. The wicked drew their sword and bent their bows to defeat the poor and the impoverished, to slaughter the followers of righteousness, but their sword will penetrate their own heart, and their bow will be broken. After King David's victory over Aram and Ammon, the Kohen priest said to the people, God your Lord goes before you, whereas the enemy depends on the might of man, you depend on the Almighty. The Plishtim relied on Goliath, and in the end he fell by the sword, and they fell with him. The Ammonites relied on Shovach, and in the end he fell by the sword, and they fell with him. Amen. One of the reasons that King David fell with Bathsheba was because he remained in Yerushalayim and sent Joab to war. Some of the sages say he should have stayed with him and went to the war. There is an opinion that says that he stayed behind in Yerushalayim to pray for the troops. Amen. According to our sages, when David asked God to test him, the Satan disguised himself as a dove perched upon the sheet behind which Bathsheba was taking a bath. David drew his bow, shot at the dove. However, rather than hitting its mark, the arrow tore a hole in the sheet and splintered the barrel in which Bathsheba was bathing. There's an opinion that her name was Bathsheba because her parents were 7 years old when they gave birth to her. King David was permitted to be with Bathsheba because she had just gotten her period, which means that she wasn't pregnant and she had a writ of divorce from her husband who went to war. The problem was, number one, Uriah was righteous. The problem was he took her too early, and the problem was he didn't die in war. He was called back from the war in hopes that he would sleep with his wife and then it would look like he got her pregnant. And that's why King David got punished. He lost a kid for that, yo. It's not a joke when you play with people. Uriah was righteous. After David got Bathsheba pregnant, he got nervous and concocted a plan to have Uriah sleep with her as to conceal her pregnancy. He had him called back from the war and invited him to his palace to eat and drink. David's plan was for Uriah to be with his wife so that it would look like he got her pregnant. Uriah was a God-fearing and honorable man. He did not want his people to think that he was relaxing with his wife when they were out to war fighting the enemy. That's what King David wanted him to go with his wife, but he wouldn't. He refused. So it's like he kind of disrespected King David because he didn't take the order of the king. But that was no excuse for King David to kill him. Uriah was a righteous man. King David gave him the letter that sealed his own face, trusting that he would not open it. Think about that, yo. Let me reread that. Uriah was a righteous man. How do we know? Because King David, when he gave him the letter saying that he was gonna, that he wanted him to die, he was going to give this letter to Yoav. He knew that he wouldn't open it. That's amazing. That speaks to the righteousness of Uriah. And I want to make sure that I said that. Rabbi Ishmael said Bathsheba was intended for David, but the problem was he took her too soon. Second book of Samuel 12:9. Why have you despised the word of God to do which is evil in my sight? Remember I told you that Hashem said that what King David did was evil? Here you go. Second book of Samuel 12:9. Why have you despised him? Because he's so righteous. Hashem is upset. Not upset because Hashem wouldn't be upset. Hashem is disappointed. Why have you despised the word of God to do which was to do that which is evil in my sight? You struck Uriah the Hittite with a sword, and his wife you took for yourself as a wife, and you had him killed by the sword of the Ammonites. You understand? One thing about Hashem, well, a billion things about Hashem I love, but... Because there's a billion miracles he's doing in my body right now. What are you talking about, bro? Absolutely, I could say that. Hashem, I love you so much because you're not fake. You're not fake. If I came and asked you a question, you would tell me the truth to my face with love. You're not fake like people. You don't deceive. You don't play games. You don't try to trick. You don't do things to purposely play with people. Everything you do is for the good. I wish people would be like that, man. Think about how many people right now would be able to help me in my life if they were really for the good. Wow, wow, wow. I can give you a list. Let me keep my mouth closed. Amen. Big time closed. Hashem, I love you for your honesty and for the way you conduct the world. And even the injustice I see by my building is justice. It might not look like it, but when you're feeding the pig, it's justice. And it is what it is. It is what it is. And you're going to tell me, oh, you said feeding the pig, you're so rude. Nah, so you see, you're trying, you're becoming like the Democrats. You're going to come now, get tough with me because I said that God is feeding the pig, and you're going to have no mercy on me and mercy on the criminal. Shame on you. Shame on you that God will destroy your demonic ways. Your demonic ways will be obliterated from the earth when God changes this world to righteousness, purity, holiness, love, respect, and honor for the glory of God's name. You want to make God's children suffer? No problem. Here, David made Uriah suffer. And what happened? He lost a kid. Get it through your head, bro. Hashem, I don't like talking like this, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, but I know the people need to hear it. Yo, even the righteous people need to hear it, because it happened to a righteous person, King David. Don't want to play games, bro. Don't want to let the Torah get the best of you. It says the Torah is a double-edged sword. You know why? Because it could be the poison of death if you let it enter you in a way that you become egotistical and think you're better than others. Or it could be a tree of life. Think about that. And slay your enemies and give you life. Double-edged sword. Think about it. You leave me one day, I'll leave you two. How? You leave me one day, I leave you one day. What's the problem, Hashem? What is this? You're getting revenge? Hashem saying, no, you don't understand. I'm constantly ascending. So if you're leaving me, you're descending. So if I go a mile up and you're going a mile down, how many miles are we apart? Two. You leave me one day, I'll leave you two. Facts. That's why I love God. Don't want to leave him. Don't want to play with him. And I want to say, thank you, Hashem. I love you so much for allowing me to say what I'm about to say. Sometimes I listen to my talks and I listen to how I talk. Sometimes I could talk a little bit strict. So I just want to make sure to let everybody know I would never want to see a person get destroyed. But if that person is making God's children suffer and he doesn't care and he's rude and smug about it, I wish that to happen to him, because it's good for him and it's good for the world. You need to understand, what does the Gemara say? When a evil person is sleeping, it's good for him and it's good for the world. I don't understand. What do you want, this guy up causing havoc everywhere he goes? No. So there you go. Change your ways, bro. Change your ways. Don't get offended if God tells you to your face, change your ways, bro. He's trying to save your soul, and I'm doing the same thing. He sent me to give you this message to let you know. Change your ways, man. I promise you, you can do it. I probably know some people that are so wicked that I promise you they have so much good in them that if they just weren't jealous, or if they just didn't have that hate, or if the ego wasn't that big, man, these people would be big. Really big. And I want to make sure I state that. Because I've been around a lot of people, and there's a few that I know that are really good. Blessed. There's one guy I know, he has a lot of charisma. Cannot take it away from, like, Donald Trump. He has a lot of charisma. That's exactly what it is. I'm not comparing Donald Trump to somebody evil, because Trump is not evil. You know what I'm saying? He did evil things. I will agree. He'll tell you that. But he changed. And after what he did for Israel and how he changes me, don't forget about it. This guy is going to heaven, guaranteed. Guaranteed. And he left some pretty decent kids in the world, or he'll be leaving, God willing, some pretty good, decent kids in the world. So that's also really good. And his love for Israel will protect him, man. Woo! Donald Trump, you are going to heaven. Yo, bro, you're going to have a nice seat up there somewhere, bro. Everything he did for Israel, bro, you couldn't even quantify, bro. Just the Abraham Accord, nobody even talks about it, bro. That is on a level that you, only God could do something like that. He was backed by God. You saw that live in this world. And may Hashem back me. Not like he backed Donald Trump, nah. Like he backed David, like he backed Moshe, like he backed Bnei Israel when he sent the 10 plagues, foiled their evil plans, Hashem. Amen. God, I love you so much, Hashem. I love making these videos, yo. I just want anybody to know that's listening. Yo, when I'm done making these videos, come take a picture of my face and see if I'm not cheesing ear to ear with a smile. I am. I promise you I am. Because it's the wisdom of God just takes over me, and I'm able to just speak and say. And of course, it's not, yo, I don't want anyone to think, oh yeah, God is hovering over me like an angel and feeding me these words. Nah, I speak from my heart. He's just in my heart. That's what it is. Like I told you earlier, you want the brain and the heart to be pure. Because if those two things are pure, everything else is holy. Hashem, please touch me with your holiness. Hashem, please hug me and put your arms around me and let me know that you love me. Hashem, be there for me. Like my mother says when she prays to you for me, to be there for me every step of the way. Love you, Hashem.